Welcome to AP Environmental Science. In this video, we are going to talk a little bit about air pollution and what it is and how it forms and some of the sources that are associated with it. Now, air pollution is anything in the atmosphere that could be harmful to humans or to the environment. And this air pollution can be coming from natural sources or from anthropogenic or human-caused sources. Now, there are two categories of air pollution. We have primary pollutants and we have secondary pollutants. Now, primary pollutants, these are anything that is emitted directly into the atmosphere from some kind of activity. So these are things like pollen is emitted directly from plants, or volcanic ash directly from a volcano, or even those products of fossil fuel combustion are emitted directly into the atmosphere. Now, secondary pollutants, these are a little different. These form in the atmosphere. So these are the product of some kind of reaction after a primary pollutant is already in the atmosphere. So in the image here on this slide, you can see that primary pollutants are turned into secondary pollutants, and usually that's after a reaction with water vapor, sunlight, or some other atmospheric gas. Now, the Clean Air Act was passed in 1970, and in the Clean Air Act, the Environmental Protection Agency established these things called National Ambient Air Quality Standards, or the NAAQS. Now, this created six criteria air pollutants, and you need to know these six air pollutants. These are sulfur dioxide, particulate matter, lead, ozone, nitrogen dioxide, and carbon monoxide. Now, pay attention here, that's carbon monoxide, not carbon dioxide. And what happened here is after these national ambient air quality standards were established, the United States made conscious efforts to reduce the concentration of these in the atmosphere, thus improving the air quality. And on this graph on this slide, you can see that from 1990 until 2018, we have continued to make improvements in the national ambient air quality. I want to zoom in here on lead. Now, lead is one of the six criteria air pollutants, and it was an additive in gasoline from the 1920s until about the 1960s. So the reason why it was added into the gasoline was to help improve those octane ratings. Remember, when you pump gas, there's a little yellow sticker on the gas pump that tells you what the octane rating is of that particular grade of gas. Now, adding lead into gasoline led to some unexpected health impacts, at least at the time. Looking back, it seems obvious that this would have happened. So the combustion of gasoline that contains lead caused that lead to then be aerosolized in the exhaust of the car. Now, inhaling this exhaust that contained lead and that lead being emitted into the atmosphere and inhaling just your everyday air, that led to children experiencing anemia, behavioral disorders, lowered IQ, reading disabilities, learning disabilities, nerve damage, and it was really devastating to children. Now, lead was not just bad for children, it was bad for adults too. So in areas that had higher concentrations of lead in the atmosphere, that also corresponded with adults who had higher levels of hypertension and cardiovascular disease. Now, in this graph, you can see that the United States made significant strides after banning lead additives into gasoline. So we can see that the average blood lead levels in humans that were tested have declined, and we see that decline directly correlated to the removal of lead used in gasoline. The combustion of fossil fuels also releases air pollution, and this disrupts the carbon cycle. Now, let's review. The carbon cycle typically involves photosynthesis, cellular respiration, moving carbon dioxide from the atmosphere into plants, and then from plants back into animal tissues doing assimilation. Those animals then do cellular respiration as they break down the food from the plants and release carbon dioxide. That's a relatively fast process. So how do fossil fuels disrupt this? Well, the energy in fossil fuels was stored in plants and perhaps animals millions of years ago during photosynthesis and assimilation. Now, after those organisms died and partially decomposed, but then were put through some heat and pressure under certain anaerobic conditions, those once living organisms were turned into coal or maybe oil or natural gas, depending on the specific set of conditions. Now, this all happened over the process of millions of years. And this carbon has not been in the atmosphere for millions of years. So when we burn this fossil fuel, we are releasing this carbon back into the atmosphere much, much faster than it was stored. The combustion of fossil fuels also is releasing any of those other elements that were stored in that peat back when that fossil fuel was starting to form. So any impurities that are in that fossil fuel are released into the atmosphere as that fuel source is being burned. Now, the specific elements and the specific impurities released depend on the conditions that that fuel was formed under. Some of the impurities in coal that you need to know about that are released when coal is burned include sulfur in the form of sulfur dioxide, toxic metals such as lead, mercury, nickel, and arsenic, and particulate matter. And we'll talk more about this particular matter in later videos. But that particulate matter is often carrying metals and other heavier elements deep into the lungs of anybody that inhales this particular air that's been polluted. Now, burning coal along with fossil fuels also releases carbon dioxide. Now, carbon dioxide is not categorized as one of those six criteria air pollutants. However, it is something to take note about because as we talk about global change and the greenhouse gas layer, this carbon dioxide you are going to see plays a pretty big role. Sulfur in particular that is released from fossil fuels is present in larger quantities in fuels that were formed from marine environments. So thinking back to that fossil fuel formation, if it was formed in that marine environment, it's going to likely have higher contents of sulfur. Now, coal that contains sulfur is going to lead potentially to acid rain and acid deposition. So we want to decrease the amount of sulfur that is being released as that coal is burned in a coal power plant. Now, there's some things that you can do to modify the power plant. So you can do that fluidized bed combustion. You can add in facilities such as a scrubber or an electrostatic precipitator that are going to remove some of that sulfur from the flue gas that are leaving the power plant. But we can also choose to use fuels that have that lower initial sulfur content. Crude oil and petroleum in particular also contains sulfur. Now, diesel fuel is pretty well regulated to try to have this low sulfur diesel fuel. And this regulation really began in 1993 because we don't want all of these trucks driving across the country on the highways to be these mini coal power plants releasing a whole bunch of sulfur into the atmosphere of communities across the country. Now, in summary, after watching this video, you should know the difference between primary and secondary air pollutants. You also need to know the six criteria air pollutants and some of the major pollutants that are released during the combustion of fossil fuels. Please leave me your questions here at the end, and I hope that as you watch this video, you were able to learn something.